The day of departure arrived. I gave the order to heave anchor at 8:45 a.m. on December 5th, 1914, and the clanking of the windlass broke for us the last link with civilization. The morning was dull and overcast, with occasional gusts of snow and sleet. The bows of the Endurance turned to the south, and the good ship dipped to the southwesterly swell. Misty rain fell during the forenoon, but the weather cleared later in the day, and we had a good view of the coast of South Georgia as we moved under steam and sail to the southeast.
Thank you.
Heavy floes held up the ship from midnight till 6 a.m. on Christmas Day. Then they opened a little, and we made progress till 11:30 a.m. when the leads closed again. We made fairly good progress on the 30th in fine, clear weather. The ship followed a long lead to the southeast during the afternoon and evening, and at 11 p.m. we crossed the Antarctic Circle. An examination of the horizon disclosed considerable breaks in the vast circle of packed ice, interspersed with bergs of different sizes. Leads could be traced in various directions, but I looked in vain for an indication of open water. The sun did not set that night, and as it was concealed behind a bank of clouds, we had a glow of crimson and gold to the southward, with delicate pale green reflections in the water of the lanes to the southeast.
Yeah,
thank you.
came suddenly. After some warning movements of the ice, the floe cracked 40 yards off the starboard bow. 2 hours later, the floe began to break up all around us, and the ship listed over 10 degrees to starboard. I had the dogs and sledges brought aboard at once, and the gangway hoisted.
Please.
ice was increasing. Frost smoke from opening cracks was showing in all directions. It had the appearance in one place of a great prairie fire, rising from the surface and getting higher as it drifted off before the wind in heavy, dark, rolling masses. Monday, October the 25th, dawned cloudy and misty. The pack within our range of vision was being subjected to enormous compression, such as might be caused by cyclonic winds, opposing ocean currents, or restriction in the channel of some description. Pressure ridges, massive and threatening, testified to the overwhelming nature of the forces that were at work. Huge blocks of ice, weighing many tons, were lifted into the air and tossed aside as other masses rose beneath them. We were helpless intruders in a strange...
What should we do?
Straining and groaning, her timbers cracking and her wounds gaping, she is slowly giving up her sentient life at the very outset of my career. The attack of the ice reached its climax at 4 p.m. The ship was hove stern up by the pressure and the driving flow, moving laterally across the stern, split the rudder, tore out the rudder post and stern. Then, while we watched, the ice loosened and the Endurance sank a little. The decks were breaking upwards and the water was pouring in below. Again the pressure began, and at 5 p.m. I ordered all hands onto the ice. The twisting, grinding floes were working their will at last on the ship. It was a sickening sensation to feel the decks breaking up under one's feet, the great beams bending, and then snapping with a noise like heavy gunfire. The floes, with the force of millions of tons of moving ice behind them, were simply annihilating the ship.
Down, bows first.